Hi everybody, how you doing today? Good to see you again, and as you can see, I'm still in Paris. In fact, this is going to be the last live stream I'm going to do in Paris for a while because if all goes according to plan, I'm going back home to New York on Saturday. So I'll be back in my usual environment over there. I see a bunch of you have checked in already. Alan Haggard says, checking in from sunny Napa. That makes me really happy to hear that Napa is sunny today because I know even if there was sun before, it was getting pretty caught up in the smoke from all the fires that were there. So that's wonderful. I hope it's not too devastating, how much ground has been burned up. It's really awful, but I guess the good news is things grow back, including vineyards, but it takes like 80 years. Anyway, I think I'm going to start by playing something free for you, and I want to dedicate this to my dad because he has been an incredible host the last, well, what's it been? It's been almost 2 months. It's been 2 months minus a week. And we were planning on being here for just a couple weeks, but it turned into much longer. So this is a free improvisation in honor of my dad. Here we go. Thank you. little improvisation for my dad, David. Yeah, he's had a rough year, really rough year. So, and he's been incredibly kind and generous on this visit. So thank you so much, Dad. So we have kind of a special show today because for the first time, I promised I'd play some really specific things today, didn't I? let's see. I think we talked about playing a piece of mine. Yeah, there was a specific request. I forget who requested it, but it was for this composition of mine called Hindi Hex, and it's a really fun piece because it's all about rhythm. It's about taking actually a North Indian tihai, which is a really rigid and specific rhythmic form, and making music from it. But it's not only that; it's taking this tihai and also using the names, the letters of the name of Gilad Hexelman, who's a really great guitarist who lives in New York and whom I've played with a number of times. I wrote this for him when we had a duo concert together, and so I took the letters from his last name, Hexelman, and it made the specific melody that I use in this piece. I like to start this one by sharing the tihai. I haven't said this in a long time. Let's see if I can do it. It goes like this. Isn't that satisfying? It's the same pattern repeating three times, but the pattern just keeps displacing over the underlying 4-4 that I'm counting out here in the traditional way on my hands. So here's Hindi Hex, suggested by Daniele Pralong. Thanks for reminding me, Daniele. And here it is. Thank you. Indie Hex, requested by Daniele Prelong. Thanks for requesting that. Mike Seitz says very messy, as in Messiaen. Yeah, I mean, it's all in one of the Messiaen modes, the diminished mode. But actually, that's a mode that he didn't invent. So there's some other composers that used it quite a bit too. Yeah, I just love, I love things like that where basically that pattern, that rhythmic pattern that goes it's complex enough that it's hard to like hold on to. It's not like obvious. But at the same time, it also makes sense. Like it's not so complex that it just doesn't make any sense, you know? So I like things like that, that kind of ride that line between legibility and not. Mark Hilliard Wilson says, are you using an octatonic scale in this? Yeah, it's all on an octatonic scale. And actually it's several octatonic scales. But the reason for that is that I took the letters to Gilad Hexelman's name. So I just, this is a random system, but I assign A is C, B is C sharp, C is D, etc. And the melody that came out was, that's Hexelman in these notes. And I realized that all the notes are in the diminished scale except for the B. So it's actually pretty cool because it fits in the diminished scale, but it has this like one out note that I think makes it interesting. Carol McGoffin says, what fun, so interesting, loved it. Well, thank you, Carol. I dig that piece. I'm glad I got a chance to play it. It is fun. Mike Seitz says, when I say Messiaen, I also refer to his use of those kinds of Eastern rhythms. Yeah, you know, I'm actually not familiar enough with his use of Indian rhythms. Maybe you can elaborate on that a little bit. Silvano Raffo says, have a potentially arguable suggestion. How about after all the requests, you managed to perform 4 minutes and 33 seconds by John Cage? We meditate all for a bit. Thinking about it would be cool if the entire chat was silent during that. I don't know, random thought. I kind of love that. I mean, it's a hilarious piece, that piece, 4 minutes and 33 seconds of silence. But in some ways, it's really profound. You know, it's performance art. It's not really music. Although, you know, Miles Davis said that all music is silence and the notes only surround the silence. So, of course, it is music too. Okay, I should play something else. Another thing that I promised you this week is I learned another Joni Mitchell song, and it's by far the hardest one of all the ones I learned. It's from her album Hijra, and I've since learned that Hijra is an Arabic word, and it means a departure, I believe. I think I'm forgetting a kind of a subtlety in what it means exactly, but it's basically a departure, a new departure. And this song is unbelievable. I mean, it has just some of the most incredibly profound lyrics, like effortlessly profound lyrics I've ever heard in a song. And it just makes me travel so much. It's like 1 second you're sitting with her in a cafe and she's describing these like prosaic things that are happening in her immediate environment. And then the next second you're thinking about the universe, you know, at its largest scale. And then the next moment it's a breakup song. And the next moment it's like just a general, incredibly wide reflection on the state of humanity. It's really just amazing. So, Teresa Sewell says, will we see the sax today? I think several people asked about the sax. You know what? It is actually in the next room. Dad, if you're watching this, would you bring the sax over? I think it's upstairs. Because I didn't get it out. But if you guys really want me to play the sax, maybe I will. Steve Cantor says that Hijra is Joni Mitchell's best album as far as he's concerned. Yeah, it's pretty unbelievable. Marilia Reese says Hijra means migration in Arabic. Okay, yeah, thank you. Well, I'm going to sing it. Here we go. Joni Mitchell's Hegira. Traveling in some vehicle, I'm sitting in some cafe, a defector from the petty wars that shell shock love away. There is comfort in melancholy when there's no need to explain. It's just as natural as the weather in this moody sky today. And our possessive couplings, so much could not be expressed. So now I am returning to myself, those things that you and I repressed. I see something of myself in everyone, just at this moment of the world, as snow gathers like bolts of lace, waltzing on a ballroom girl. Whether you do or you do not resign, whether you travel the breadth of extremities or stick to some straighter line. Now there's a man and a woman sitting on a rock. They're either gonna thaw out or freeze. Listen, strains of Benny Goodman coming through the snow and the pine wood trees. I'm porous with travel fever, but you know I'm so glad to be on my own. Still somehow the slightest touch of a stranger can stir up trembling in my bones. I know no one's gonna show me everything. We each come and go unknown, each so deep and superficial, between the forceps and the stone. Finality to eternity. Then I looked at myself here, chicken scratching for my immortality. In the church they light the candle, and the wax rolls down like tears. I see the hope and the hopelessness I witness 30 years. We're only particles of change, I know, orbiting around the sun. But how can I have that point of view when I'm always bound and tied to someone? Why flag
winter chimneys wave truce against the moon. In the mirrors of a modern bank, from the window of a hotel
crazy. I mean, it really blows my mind. And the original with Jaco Pastorius overdubbing multiple lines, it's just really perfect. I mean, it's funny because some people, when they hear it nowadays, in some ways the sounds being used and the sound of Jaco Pastorius on the bass can sound a little bit dated, I guess, to some people. But to me, it's just I don't know. It's just of such incredibly high quality, and those lyrics are so mind blowing that I just love it. I absolutely love it. Let's see. Daniele Prolong says, "Thank you so much imagery in this song. On top of that, I was mentally merging Dan's left hand with Jaco." Yeah, but it's true. So much imagery. It's like she's such she's so good at expressing things through images, right? It's like, the way they say in writing, you're supposed to show and not tell. She's a master of showing. And these images are so strong that suddenly you're just pulled in all these different directions. It just really fascinates me. The first time I heard it was only a few years ago, because I was actually, I'd been listening to Joni Mitchell for a long time, but I'd actually not heard Hejira for some reason, because it's not nearly as famous as Blue. And I was pretty blown away when I heard that. AJ Shopek says, "Roadrunner or my mom will shoot." wow, my dad's brought me my saxophone. Incredible. Thank you. Thanks, Dad. It's not my saxophone, by the way. It's a saxophone that's lent to me by a friend in Paris. But anyway, since you all asked so much, maybe I will actually play something on it. Teresa Sewell says, "Wow, his Hero stirred up many emotions." Yeah, I feel like there's something in there for everyone. It's just so much power in that song. Okay, so what am I doing now? Maybe I will play Roadrunner since you know AJ Chopek, he said his mom will shoot. Whatever that means. I hope she's not holding a gun to my head. Michael Loftus says Hajira is a masterpiece. Anyway, yeah, I'm gonna play Roadrunner. Here we go. Oh my god, Petra Hayden is with us. Thank you, Petra. She says, I love that song. Yeah, I do too. I would love to hear you sing that song, Petra. I don't think I've ever heard you sing any Joni Mitchell, but I would absolutely love to hear you sing that song. And I will say, of the three songs that of hers that I've learned, Both Sides Now, A Case of You, and now Hajira, it's by far the hardest, even though the melody, it's almost like she purposely gave herself the exercise of writing a melody that fits in a tiny range. I mean, the melody fits between those two notes. It's a major sixth. So that's tiny compared to most of her songs, which are super wide in range. So the melody is actually, easier from a vocal point of view, I guess, although I wouldn't know. But just lyrically, and even in terms of the detail she brings to the notes in every phrase, it's pretty intricate. Okay, here's Roadrunner, you guys. Here we go. My song, Roadrunner. Thank you. That was Roadrunner, a song of mine. I've played that a number of times on the stream. I'm sure a bunch of you have heard it, but you know, it's all about using this idea of the rock groove, you know, and fracturing it, compressing it, stretching it so it becomes, and compressing it so it becomes. Yeah, like that. Marilia Reese says, "Would love to hear about your composing process. Improv, record, transcribe, play a bit, transcribe, play more, straight out of head onto paper or via technology. Must be natural to memorize own versus other stuff, or am I totally off base here?" Okay, well, first of all, I often actually find it harder to memorize my own stuff than other people's stuff, depending on what it is. But you know, a lot of the music that I might learn, you know, for instance, a jazz standard or a piece by Joni Mitchell or a piece by Piazzolla or even a piece by Bach, a lot of these things kind of fit within a framework that I already know. And you know, there was a study made on chess players. They found that if they arranged a chessboard according to a position in an actual game, even if this game had never been played in the history of humanity, if the piece that was on the board actually emerged from an actual game, grandmaster chess players were able to memorize it extremely quickly. They were able to memorize the position extremely quickly just from looking at the board. Whereas people who weren't advanced chess players obviously couldn't memorize it really very well at all. But if they arranged the pieces on the chessboard randomly, not in a way that could have arisen from a game, it turns out that grandmaster chess players are no better at memorizing it than your average person off the street. And that's pretty interesting. I mean, that has to do with, you know, the way that our minds organize information. And so ultimately for me, it's easier to memorize something that falls within an organizational process that I know, you know, for instance, tonal harmony or, well, that would be the main system that I know. But my pieces often tend to kind of look for other ways of organizing information. And sometimes it's kind of tough to memorize, to be honest. David Shine says, "Fabulous, going to dance to that." Yeah, David, I'd love to see that. But to answer the second part of your question, Marlia, my compositional process most often is just me sitting down with a piece of sheet music and just writing. You know, I might search for something and just write it down. I've also written quite a bit with computer, but yeah, pen and paper is the most frequent for me. Yeah, Jan Zamofsky, the title of the piece I just played is Roadrunner, and it's off my last trio record with Thomas Morgan and Nate Wood, which is called 11 Cages. Okay, guys, another thing that you requested last week was Piazzolla. You requested some tango music, and then I think we got specific about some Piazzolla. So you know what? I've been meaning to learn a couple of Piazzolla's pieces for a while, and so I got them out, and I'm gonna play a couple for you. I think I'm gonna start with Oblivion by Piazzolla, which is, yeah, it's an incredible mood piece. Here we go, Oblivion. Thank you. Oblivion by Astor Piazzolla. Total mood piece. How about the all-time Piazzolla classic, which amazingly I've never played solo before. This is called Libre Tango. Thank you. There you go. Some Piazzolla for you. That was a tough one, actually. Getting that, doing that. The bass line and that ostinato in the left hand and improvising over it. Kind of an interesting challenge, which I wouldn't say I've totally mastered here. But really fun challenge. And that's one of the things I really love about doing these live streams is you guys inspire me to do some new stuff. Kristen Berardi says it suits him. I think wears it well, honoring what was written, but given the Dan treatment. I see that was a reply to something. Anyway, Kristen, wonderful to have you with us. As you guys know, Kristen's another really great singer. She lives in Australia. I wish we could have you singing right now. Joyce Glasgow says, Oblivion, a white gardenia presented on the palm of an outstretched hand. Librotango, a contrasting, dark, shadowy flamenco dancer silhouetted by firelight. I love it. So poetic. Okay, so what are we going to do now? Oh, I almost forgot. I almost forgot that my dad brought me the saxophone. Okay. If you really, 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 really insist, I will play something on the saxophone if I can get this thing open. That is. This all happened because during my live stream with Thomas Enko, that was a ticketed live stream, he played some violin because he plays really good violin, and I played some sax. It was pretty fun, actually. We did this free improvisation where we traded back and forth. I don't even know. I'm missing some parts here. Yeah, actually, I can't even play anything for you because I don't have the mouthpiece. Oh, wait a minute. I do have the mouthpiece. Amazing things happening on this live stream, you guys. Here we go. Okay, how does this go together anyway? If I were an actual sax player, I would be doing this a lot more gracefully. Okay, here we go. As you can see, this reed has not been wetted or anything else. Hopefully it'll work. Okay. Let's see. What should I play on the sax, you guys? My repertoire is limited. Actually, it's not that limited. I can basically play anything that I know, but I can't play it fast or particularly well. Joyce Glasgow says an improv. Okay, I could do a free improvisation on the sax. Why not? That could be fun. How does this work? No, that's not it. Grace Chu says Harlem Nocturne. That's beyond my pay grade on saxophone, unfortunately. I wish. Dave Kaufman says a free improv taken outside. And Jen Detour says your choice or impro. Okay, I think it's free improv, you guys. That's gonna be the vibe. Okay, here we go. Let's see if this works. I don't even know how I'm gonna mic this. How about we try like this? Thank you. So how was that? A little free improv on the sax. Frank Geyer says, unbelievable surprise. Well, thanks. I mean, yeah, I guess I gotta keep surprising you guys somehow, or why would you keep coming? Okay, you know what? While I have this in my hands, I wanna do a little tribute to Lee Konitz. I'm gonna play one of his favorite songs. Body and Soul. Yeah, here we go. I was gonna play a second chorus on that, but actually my cheeks started getting tired because I never play. I literally haven't picked this thing up in like 2 years, and I only picked it up for that live stream with Tomasenko for about 15 minutes or like 5 minutes. So that's it. That's it for today, guys, on the saxophone. And what are we gonna do now? I think it might be time to play one last thing today. Mary Leah Reese says, going to unpack my clarinet. Excellent idea. I always recommend unpacking clarinets. And playing them too. Yeah, Renana Gutman, who's a dear friend and a great pianist, sends me some emoji applause. I don't know if that's sarcastic, but I appreciate it anyway, Renana. Mike Seitz says, I like your soft, sweet sound on the sax. Yeah, that's probably because I can't really do anything else but a soft sound because my cheeks are really, really, really out of shape. Oh, Renana Gutman requests Inutile Paysagem. That is, oh yeah, mic level. Thank you for reminding me. There we go. I love that you guys are on my case for technical things. Steve Cantor reminded me to raise my mic level for the vocals. Maybe a little bit more, eh? How's that? You know what? I think Inutile Paysagem is a great request for a closer. I'm gonna do that. Inutile Paysagem. David Shine requests 7+5 as a time signature. Yeah, I don't know. I don't know about 7+5. That's 12. Yeah, I guess we can do that. I guess we can do 12. It's 3 times 4. Kind of going between decomposing 12 as 7 and 5 and 4 times 3 or 3 times 4. Okay, let's try that. How about a key, you guys? I'm being a little masochistic here, asking for a key for Inutile Paysagem, but let's do it. I want to keep this fresh. So, do you have a key for me? In the meantime, I'm going to think a little bit about 7+5. So we could do like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah, I mean, a lot of interesting options there. Teresa Sewell says C minor. It's a major, but okay. Grace Chu says A flat. I like A flat. That sounds nice. A flat. Renana Gutman requests G major, but that's the original key, Renana. So we're gonna do it in A flat. Grace Chu's request, and I'm gonna try to do it in 12. How's that gonna go? I don't know. I think that's gonna be tough. I'm just gonna do it as a bossa nova, but in A flat. Here we go. Thank you. All right, that was Inutile Paysagem by Antonio Carlos Jobim in A-flat to close. Ronald Rosenthal says, a lovely afternoon of music. I lost the comment, actually. Safe travels, and we look forward to hearing from you in Park Slope. I don't actually live in Park Slope. I live on the other side of Prospect Park in Brooklyn from Park Slope. But close enough. And Joyce Glasgow says, you are ending with one of my favorites, Useless Landscape. It is a special song, and so many moods can be expressed in this melody and approaches to it. Yeah, that's true. Actually, you know, the original, or one of the original recordings with Jobim, is really slow. And it's absolutely beautiful as a slow song. In some ways, maybe it should be played as a slow song. But I've always enjoyed playing it fast, too. Teresa Sewell says, terrific finish. Maybe you can compose something on your hijira from Paris to New York. Bon voyage. Thanks. That's going to help me remember what hijira means. It means a migration. My migration from Paris to New York. I do like composing on the plane, actually. That's really fun. Oh, MJ Williams, who's an amazing singer as well, and trombone player, is with us. Hi, MJ. Renana, thank you for requesting that song. And Mark Mitchell, next week some Art Tatum he requests. Well, the thing about Art Tatum is that I don't think he composed any songs that I know of. I might be wrong about that. And if I am, please correct me. But you know, he was just like an unparalleled interpreter of songs. But so if you play some Art Tatum, it kind of means you're playing his improvisation on a standard or something like that, which, you know, I've actually been meaning to learn one of those for a while, but it'll take me a while. So not next week. Jan Zermofsky says, another Monday, another life-enriching live stream from Mr. Tepfer. Well, thanks. I'm glad you feel that way. I bet it was because of the saxophone. Paul James Brown, thanks for joining us, Paul, from Hawaii. Yeah, actually, Paul says, let us know when you do a paid event again, a ticketed event. And I have something very, very, very exciting to announce. On November 5th, 2 days after the American election, which I pray gets us out of this proto-fascist nightmare we've been living. And I hope we can all vote, and I hope you agree with me that Biden, at the very, very least, would be someone who listens to the opinions of experts and tries to keep our relations with our foreign allies good, and also maybe does something about climate change and about universal healthcare. Wouldn't that be nice? Anyway, I hope you can all vote. And anyway, 2 days after the election, I'm going to do a duo ticketed live stream over Jack Tripp with the incredible Christian McBride, one of the greatest jazz bassists out there. He has 6 Grammys, Christian does, and he also introduced and narrated the incredible video that NPR did about my use of Jack Tripp, or about Jack Tripp in general, and it featured my use of Jack Tripp. So there's a connection there. And also Christian McBride and I have played both live and on record with Renee Fleming, with the great soprano Renee Fleming. So this is something I'm really gonna look forward to. November 5th, 2 days after the election, duo with the great Christian McBride. Right now, the tickets aren't up yet, but they will be soon. They definitely will be by next Monday. And next Monday, I'll be back at the same time from Brooklyn. It's been great being in Paris, but I'm also excited to be back home. So I'm looking forward to catching you there. All right, everybody. Thanks again for joining me today. It's just been an absolute pleasure. And I hope you stay well and really look forward to seeing you next week. Thanks for forcing me to play the saxophone.